to have a professor Ang Hee Barry Sticky. So the first name there. So I call him Ang Hee, that's a French name, but sometimes when people are not happy with him, people call him Henry. So. And Ang Hee received his PhD in 1975, and then he go back and forth between Chicago and Paris. And he was in very high positions, such as he was the director for the Mass Finance Program in Chicago, and also he's director in the Institute of Social Sciences in Paris. Right now, he's the Dean of Research in PSL. So PSL is called Paris Science and Humanity Research University. And although he did a lot of high-level administration jobs, but never delayed his research. Okay. So he has a wide research interest and published a lot of papers. And more important, also like his papers are very influential. For example, his citation is more than 12,000. So really remarkable in mathematics. And also he's very dedicated to education, including mentoring students and mentoring postdocs. He has more than 25 PhD students and more than 80 descendants and the numerous postdocs, okay, including myself, partially. Yeah, so, okay, so, today he will talk about some models in social sciences and ecology. Okay. So the title is here, so I leave the time to Ang Hee.
I'm really delighted and honored to be invited to give you this distinguished lecture here. It's my first time at this university. I'm very impressed with the dynamism and everything I see in this university. So I'm really particularly glad to be here. And also, I should say that PSL has some kind of exchange agreement with HKUST. So I hope that in the future this is used by people who want to go to Paris and maybe for some future exchanges. So I'm going to talk to you indeed about some models in ecology, not so much social sciences, even though at the very end you'll see that there is an interpretation of what I'm going to tell you that is relevant for social sciences. But I'm really going to tell you about, the problem I want to tell you about is something, it's really a very old and one of the central questions of ecology of certain animals. Why do animals form, so like wolves, for instance, why do they form territories? And what can you say about, and why some others don't, and what is the advantages, and what is the role of these territories? So, so let me tell you a little bit. So, Telling insisted very much that I give this non-specialized talk, so I'm going to give a background. And maybe some of you know already, are very familiar with this background. The first third of my lecture, maybe the first quarter of my lecture, will be really background and well-known things about population dynamics. So first of all, so what is population dynamics? So population dynamics is you want to understand how certain populations of living beings evolve, how they, in particular, if you're interested in ecology, you want to understand how these populations interact with their environment. And one, for those of you who have never heard about this, it's important to keep in mind that population by population, we mean very many different things. So trees, for instance, is such a population. Trees can diffuse, can progress, can change by disseminating at very low scale, of course, low speed. But it's one such population. Bacteria, this is E. coli, for instance. Bacteria is also a population, such a population. Insects or mammals or fishes, all these are what we call populations that I have in mind here, okay? So it's important to know. So in these type of things have been very important in ecology, for instance, to study how this evolution, of course, but also population genetics. Recently, there are many studies that are devoted to understand how climate change may affect the distribution, spatial distribution of populations. Such studies also are very important in epidemiology, how diseases diffuse, and also many other topics are implications for agriculture and human intervention. So here, what I want to talk to you about is the revolution of territorial behavior. Okay, so what we can say about territories that are occupied by certain animals. So let me start. I will start with a very with some of the basic elements, and because I'm going to talk about predator-prey models. So let me go back to the very origin of predator-prey models. Predator-prey models date back to two important mathematicians. One is Alfred Lotka, was in the US, was a chemist and mathematician. He was interested in mathematical modeling of chemical reactions. And the other one is Vito Volterra, who was an Italian mathematician, beginning of the 20th century. He's a very important mathematician. He did many contributions to analysis, in particular. He was, in some sense, the founder of the theory, mathematical theory of integral equations. And also, it's very interesting to note that, in some sense, he's the founder of mathematical ecology. I think it's fair to say that he's the first one who really, as a mathematician, tried to lay the mathematical grounds for ecology. How did he come about to introduce this so-called Lotka-Volterra equation or Lotka-Volterra system? So the story is an interesting story. It started actually by observation that at the end of the First World War in the Adriatic Sea, on the shores of Italy, when people measured how much, you know, annually you had the catch of predators and prey, and so predators means essentially were sharks, and prey here basically meant sardines, and how much were caught, and the observation which was a puzzle was that at the end of World War I, so in 1918, the percentage of prey, so of sardines which were caught, really diminished with respect to that of sharks. And this was a paradox. The reason being that during the war, essentially the fishing was to a large extent interrupted. So people expected that at the end of World War I, when fishing would resume, that there would be a large amount of sardines, very large amount of fishes that are usually prey to this. And it is the son-in-law of Vito Volterra, whose name Umberto d'Ancona, was a biologist, came with his figures to Volterra and asked him if there was some way to understand this. And that's how Volterra started to think about this problem. And he understood very clearly that this was related to the interaction between predators and prey. It was not just you could not just simply isolate the fact that there were less fishes being caught to account for an increase in the number of fishes, because there was this interaction and it could, by itself, the number of prey could reduce. And that led him to introduce the so-called Lotka-Volterra system, which is one of the basic building bricks of mathematical ecology. So here you have the data from. So it's interesting to know that you had data on this, and here is a Lotka-Volterra system. What are the basic ideas of this system? The basic ideas are that you have two populations. Let's say we isolate two populations, that of prey and that of predators, and you can think of U and W as numbers if you want. If you can also change it to certain densities if you prefer, but let's think of them as numbers. And the dynamics is this. If you have prey by themselves, then prey would grow. So growing means that the change, instantaneous change, that's the time derivative of u, would be equal to lambda u, certain constant times u. So they grow exponentially. That would be a Malthus population growth law. And this was later corrected. It's quite commonly accepted now to be by Verhulst in particular, a mathematician, a demographer named Verhulst, to include a term, a correcting term, so that it doesn't, the population U doesn't go above a certain threshold, which is K here. So you replace lambda U by lambda U times 1 minus U over K. And K here is called the maximum carrying capacity, if you want, the maximum population of price, right? When u exceeds k, you see u prime becomes negative, so you want to go back to, u cannot really exceed k. That is the so-called logistic law of population growth, really one, again, the basic building block of population dynamics. Lambda is so-called, so those parameters, lambda and k, are very commonly used in ecology. Lambda is called the intrinsic growth rate. So intrinsic means if nothing else happens, initially, if you want, if u is very small, u grows at the rate u prime equals lambda u. And now, for predators, if they are left alone, there are no preys, they just die out, because predators can only survive when there are preys. So, you know, so wolves, for instance, wolves, if there are no preys, they die out. They cannot feed simply from trees. By the way, wolves, you know, are proverbially hungry, but they really are hungry most of the time. And so if they are left alone, they die out, and die out at a rate mu. So if nothing else happens, you have this time derivative of w is a certain negative constant times w. So it decreases exponentially. So mu is a decay rate of predators. Now, this is if they are left alone. If they have an interaction, then there is something which is called predation. So the predators, when they meet a prey and are able to overcome it, they would feed on this, and so therefore there is a predation rate, and the predation rate is naturally considered to be proportional to the density u times the density w, or the number of u times w. The more you have wolves, the more you have of predation, but if you have fewer preys, the predation rate will come down. So it's proportional. You can think of this as a probability of encounters between predators and preys, wolves and deers, for instance. Okay, now, so this means that for the preys, for u, the u population, this means a decrease by factor by term minus k u w. K is the number of losses in the prey population owing to predation, and likewise, the W grows because it can feed. It can feed on encounters, and this happens at a certain rate P, rate at which the population grows, given the fact that there is predation. So when you put everything together, you end up with a Lotka-Volterra system. So this is a basic system, which is U prime is equal to lambda U minus K U W. W prime is, on the contrary, minus mu W plus P times U W. And you have initial data U0, W0. So all the constants that appear here, lambda, k, mu, and p, are positive, and they have a natural ecological interpretation. Okay? So when you look at this system, it's well known that if you look at the phase plane here of this system for u and w positive, you see what's happening. So there are certain lines which are important here, one, and you have a system which rotates around this. There is a certain equilibrium here, and basically what you see, trajectories are given by this in the phase plane. So you see that fact that if you look at this system, you will see oscillations whereby, you know, at some points the predators grow, here also the prey grow, but at some point the prey will decrease here, and the predators will decrease here, and the predators continue to decrease the prey. So you see the oscillations, and they are in this system. They can be without any other effect. They can be decrease of the number of. And this, in some sense, explains exactly the observations that D'Ancona had made to Volterra, namely that simply by the fact that you live alone preys, preys can start increasing. They increase again in number because you don't have fishing. But because you don't have fishing, the predators make a feast out of preys. They eat a lot of sardines. So the predators grow a lot. And then eventually, you know, everything will turn down. So you maybe, even if you diminish fishing, even if there is no fishing, basically, the number of predators can be large with respect to the number of preys. So this is the explanation. So this was because of the success of this theory, this is how mathematical ecology was founded, because there was an explanation, and in some sense, you could not understand this without a mathematical model. So, I want to show you later on for much more complex questions in some sense that, again, the mathematical model really helps you to understand what is happening in nature. Okay, so this is a system, and there is another, there are many applications, which it has been checked in many, many frameworks. In particular, there is this nice, so it's interesting how the data came, right? So the previous case was the data where the fisheries from the Adriatic Sea. There's another set of data which is very interesting, which comes from the northern Canada, from the Hudson Bay Company. Hudson Bay Company was specialized in getting furs from animals. And two animals from which they were getting furs in particular are the lynx from northern Canada, and the hare, the snow hare, so something which lives in the snow. Those two have very good furs to resist to cold, so people used to do to sell them. And trappers would go in the region of the Hudson Bay, would chase these animals, and you would have very good accounting records of how many were caught every year. So you know, we know with quite, you know, of course, it's not direct observations of how many they are, but it's a trustworthy representation of how many animals there are, because you could think, you know, that the people were hunting always at the same rate. So we have a very good accounting for this, and you see that between 1845, so the accounting goes back a long time, in 1935, you see exactly the type of things predicted by the Lotka-Volterra system. Here you have the population of lynxes. Here you have the population of hares, as represented by the number of pelts which were sent, which were gathered. And you see that you have these oscillations, and it's quite in good agreement with the Lotka-Volterra system of equations. So that's quite interesting already. Now, you can also start by including carrying capacity. So if you include carrying capacity of prey, so maximum number of prey, you end up by adding this term, and you see what you get are trajectories which are not as before staying away, but will eventually converge. This like acts effectively as a damping term, and you will eventually converge to the unique equilibrium, which is here. Okay, so all these are simulations of the equations I'm showing to you. Okay, so now the next topic in this. So this was the basis. This is the basis of population dynamics, how you represent total population. So up to now, I only told you something about overall figures. Up to now, the populations we saw were figures of total amount of populations in the Adriatic Sea or in the northern Canada. And now you want to add the effect of space. So for space, you need to take into account for what I'm going to talk about, you need to take into account the fact that animals may move or will move around. And the very classical way to take this into account is to assume that animals have random motions, and the most classical way of representing this would be the Brownian motion. Let me say at this point, at this juncture, so I'm going to work with this, therefore I will have the Laplacian, but you, of course, you may use other diffusion operators than the Laplacian, and you may have direct oriented diffusion with drifts, you may have anisotropic operators, and so forth. But I'm going to, so a lot of things can be generalized to this, and you may also have, instead of the Laplacian, you may have an integral term, which is the probability that something at place Y will go to place X. So a certain kernel here, J of XY, which represents again the probability kernel, telling you how many of the individuals at position Y will go to position X. And likewise, you have people leaving position X, so this is the same type of representation of movement through an integral kernel, okay? So if you use Brownian motion and you do the right scaling, what you end up with is an equation, which is this fundamental equation of population dynamics, which is ut, so time derivative, minus a certain positive constant capital D times Laplace of u, and I'll tell you in a minute what Laplace of u is equal to lambda u times 1 minus u over k. So this term is the same as before. It's the logistics law. So lambda is intrinsic growth rate. K is a maximal carrying capacity. And the Laplacian of u, as you know, is simply the sum of square second derivatives of u, d to u by dxi squared. And you sum from 1 to n. Usually in the applications, you will think of n to be 2 or 3. OK, so this is this equation. The coefficient d here plays an important role. It's an amplitude. It's an amplitude coefficient. It tells you how fast or how far the individuals move randomly. Okay, so d is a mobility coefficient, and is a mobility coefficient or diffusion coefficient. It's usually called diffusion coefficient. You can think the higher capital D, the higher the mobility of individuals in this population. Okay. And as I said before, you can replace this operator by other diffusion operators, including, you know, more general second-order partial differential operators involving drift, involving what you want. Or you may think of these as non-local diffusion, so individuals can jump from a location to another like this. You can have a jump process rather than the Brownian process underlying this, and so forth. But I'm going to stick to this equation, which is a fundamental equation of biology and reaction diffusion equations. So one of the properties that this equation has, the Fischer KPP. KPP stands for Kolmogorov, Petrovsky, and Piskunov. And Fischer is, they did that independently in the 1930s to introduce this equation. It's a very, very interesting case. Fischer is the same one as a statistician and studied these PDs. Both of them were interested in genetics, how genetic traits progress in certain populations. And one of the important features of the Fischer KPP equation is that it sustains traveling waves. And so here's an example of what you have such a wave here. You see, so you start from an initial datum here. You start from an initial datum, and eventually, after some time, there will be. And so this happens at a very precise speed, which is which you can compute mathematically. And this speed is called the invasion, or classical invasion speed, or we call it, mathematicians, we call it KPP speed, invasion speed, but it's really one of the classical, again, elements in mathematical ecology, because in many instances, you can compute some of this, the constant lambda at least. You can compute what it is, you just do some observation. You can compute what capital D is, you can do experiment to see how individuals move around. And it's hard to compute K, but K fortunately doesn't enter the formula for the invasion speed. And you can compare what you get with a theory. So that's really something which is used in mathematical ecology. So so this is a KPP equation. Now, how do we take into account both elements? So I've described to you separately the growth of the population and the diffusion effect. If you want to combine those two things, now we are going to talk about populations U and W, prey and predators. And both of them are distributed spatially. Their distribution depends on x and on time. And therefore, you are led to an equation, which is this one. So you have the same equation as before. I'm going to take k to be I'm going to take this equation. So ut minus d Laplace of u equals u times 1 minus w, okay? And wt is minus a different diffusion coefficient here, Laplace w, equals to w minus 1 plus u. So this is the same equation, same right-hand side. I didn't include here the maximum carrying capacity. I'm taking it to be infinite if you want. I just take the interaction between u and w in those terms here. And for simplicity, we'll always assume that this happens in a certain region, omega, and we impose no flux outside this region. There is no exchange of populations across the boundary of this region. And we can compare with the averages, the spatial averages of this population, and you see that if you do this, you're not, because of these conditions, because the Laplacian, the integral of Laplacian here and here vanish, you're basically left with those two equations, which are very similar to what you have for the Slotka-Volterra system without space for the moment, okay? And indeed, you can see that I will show you here, this is space, evolution in respect to space, and this here will be the average of the total populations, okay? Total population. So let me do it. So you see what's happening here. You see, so it depends on space, of course. You see an oscillation, and you see that the average is very much like the total population. So this microscopic description, if you want, leads you to something which is very analogous to what you have seen before. In particular, you saw that the amplitude of oscillations was dampened. So it's somehow not the oscillation in time, but in space. So somehow these two populations will converge to homogeneous space-independent situation. Now, okay, so this is, I've described you these models, and I want now to go to really the main topic, which is the new part of what I want to describe to you. It's a problem where we try to think about the question of why, how animals form, why are there some social behaviors, and why animals form territory. So just here there are a few pictures of animals which live indeed in packs, so wolves in particular are here, and of course lions, and lions in particular are very, very good at hunting, like wolves are very good at hunting because they're in packs. So the usual answer to why they form packs is because they increase their efficiency at hunting, as you see here with bisons. I won't talk about this. This is chimpanzees, and it's been reported that chimpanzees can wage wars, actual wars. They go, this was a picture taken, was a shock to many people. But, this was an army of chimpanzees invading the territory of another army. But so the usual answer is this one, all right? So what I want to say from this picture is that it's easy to justify a posteriori why there is, what are the advantages of social behavior. So one of them, one clear advantage, is the efficiency of hunting. Efficiency of hunting is certainly increased by the fact, even for certain animals like wolves or lions, it really depends on the fact that there are packs. But also, there are other advantages, in particular the fact that they can take care of their offsprings in a more efficient manner by being a pack rather than being individuals. But first of all, the first observation is that not all animals are social, of course. And also, the social structure should be understood as a consequence of having a pack rather than being the cause for having a pack. So anyway, so social structure, I think, would emerge from a non-social one. So the question is, why do selfish animals aggregate and develop a social behavior? Why are some animals territorial? Why are not all animals territorial social? And how are territories shaped? What are the driving mechanisms? So I want to present to you an approach to this question. I will avoid the mathematical complications. I will just tell you the ideas behind what we do. So first of all, I just want to show you this a very important observation, which was done by radio tracking data. And this is these are packs of coyotes. So each dot is a coyote in Yellowstone, in some part of Yellowstone territory, Yellowstone National Park, sorry. And they were identified as belonging to certain packs. So red one is one pack, the green one is another pack, the blue one is another pack, the blue, light blue is another pack, and the magenta here is still another pack. Those points here, those black marks, represent dens, you know, dens where animals somehow can hide and congregate. And so each pack has its own main den here, which is represented like this. And you see that, of course, there are a few outliers, but basically there is an enormous segregation between different packs. So it's just they don't mix between packs. And this was done, this is a very important study which was done by Moorcroft, Lewis, Mark Lewis, and Crabtree in 2006 and reported these differences. Again, you could say why. So this is a very, in fact, it's really an overwhelming question. Why are there five packs here in this territory? So six, five packs. Why are there five packs? And also, what determines their size? Why isn't there just a single pack here in this area, in this territory? So I want to give you some ideas in this direction. And you'll see that what we believe is that it's really through the mathematical modeling that one can understand these questions. So first of all, so what we want to say is this, what we want to understand is a situation where once you have an environment, let's say a domain omega, you have prey U, you have disorganized predators and W, how territoriality emerges and you have prey, and instead of having one W, you will have W1, which is density of a certain pack, W2 for another pack, WN, another pack, right? So this is a question we want to understand. So let me tell you the model we use to understand this. So basically, it's a model which is of the Lotka-Volterra type with predators and prey. I've already shown you this model. So this model is the results of the fact that the prey population U evolves according to this equation. Ut minus D Laplacian U is equal to lambda times U. So this is reproduction rate. Minus mu times u squared. So you see that lambda over mu is a maximum carrying capacity. And when mu is very small, the carrying capacity is infinite. So when mu is zero, there's infinite carrying capacity. And then there is a predation rate, minus kuw. There is no loss in generality in taking the same constant upstairs and downstairs. So ut is this is the this is the equation for the prey. They grow, there's a maximum carrying capacity, and they are lost to predation. Whereas the predator's population is as dynamics given by WT minus D, they have another coefficient of diffusion, little d, equals minus omega W. Omega is the rate of loss, minus there is also, you can put here a kind of the equivalent of a maximum carrying capacity, even though you don't need this, plus k times uw. This is results from predation here. All parameters are positive, and typically we are interested in the fact that in the situation where mu and uw are small. So the issue of maximum carrying capacity is not there. It's not an issue, but mu is going to be small in this. Okay, and so let me tell you, so this is a simple model when you have one predator and only and one prey. So what is the model we want to study? We want to study the situation when we have several groups of predators. Let's call them W1, W2, WN. So each acts with the prey. So WI, for instance, satisfies this equation, WT minus D Laplace of WI is minus omega WI minus mu WWI squared. And there is a predation. Predation only involves U times WI, benefits to the group I. Whereas what changes here for the prey is that it's lost to all the elements, all the other groups. So whenever it meets one of the wolves, W1, W2, WN, it's lost. So the effect on the prey is a summation of this term, KU times sum of WI, okay? That's natural. But now what we add to this is a competition term between the various packs. So whenever there's the pack W1 is in competition with all the other ones, not only in competition, but they're very hostile, which is what is observed in nature. When you have different packs of wolves, for instance, when they meet, they can kill each other. Very often, or coyotes would be the same. So there's a very strong competition or interaction, negative interaction, or repulsion, you may say, between the various elements. So the equation, the new element here to be taken into account, that the WI equation involves an extra term. And this extra term is a certain positive coefficient beta, WI, times the summation of WJ for all other J's. So WI will interact with all other J in a negative manner. And so this is a competition term, again, of the Lotka-Volterra term, but it's an intraspecific a competition term, namely with other walls, but of different packs. So this is a new part here with respect to Lotka-Volterra and diffusion and APP equations. So you have this new thing. And what we're, so beta here is the intensity of hostility there is between the various groups. But we are interested in understanding what happens when beta is very large. Okay? So this is, and the good example to have in mind is packs of wolves. So they all compete for the same prey, or say you could be a number of prey. It's a certain density. It doesn't need to be a single species. It represents the availability of food, if you want. But they compete also very. They are very hostile to one another. And what we want to do is to compare this equation to the situation where wolves are indistinguished. They only one. What is the effect of having two groups, three groups, or only one group? So when there is one group, there is no term like this, right? There is no, this term is not there. So how can we compare these things? So this is a game, the name of the game I want to tell you about. Okay, so the complete system is what I wrote here. And so ut minus d Laplace u equals u times lambda minus mu u minus k sum of wi, that's the old term. And here you have wi times minus omega minus mu wi plus ku, this is gain from predation, minus this term of competition, of hostility, of aggressiveness with other packs. Okay, so remember that here in this case, lambda over mu is a, what we called k before, is a capacity, carrying capacity of prey. So the larger k, the larger the prey could grow if left alone. So we have many things we want to do here. First of all, there is this existence and regularity of solutions. I will not tell you more about, but we're mostly interested in understanding what is the dynamic behavior of this system when t goes to infinity. What's happening when beta goes to plus infinity, when you have more and more hostility between groups, which is what is observed in nature. And what can you say about having very large number of n over partition? If you have many, many groups, what's happening when you have many groups? Okay, so this is the... I will come back to this in a minute, okay, later on. So, first of all, two predators and one prey system when beta is equal to zero. Here are some example here. So beta equals to zero means there is no hostility between groups. So you have two groups to start with, but you know hostility. What is happening here, so the same as before. In fact, you see that the two groups tend to homogenize, simply because they are undistinguishable. They don't fight between each other, so they're the same. There's only one group. And you have the same dynamics as what I showed you before. This is what I have shown you here. And let's now take a term here when there is a beta. This is beta to be 1 here, so there is a certain hostility, but not very large. And let's see what this thing, what happens here. So you see what happens here, as opposed to the previous case, is that you have the formation here, of, there will be converging not to the homogeneous state, but there will be some spatial inhomogeneities between the two groups. The two groups will tend not to overlap too much, and there is a formation of a bump here. I will tell you in a minute what this means, but let's look at the much larger coefficient of interaction, hostility. So beta here is 100. Let's see the same system I showed you what's happening here. So you see there is competition. And the populations evolve in such a way as to not overlap. So this is what we call segregation. You see you have group 1, group 2. They essentially don't, there's a very small region where you can find individuals, very few individuals of each one of them. But they basically have segregated and are completely separate. Whereas the prey here, so is the same as before, except that in this region, there are very few wolves, or very few predators, if you want. So in this region, they can grow. And that's the secret of why it's advantageous to have hostility, really. There is so-called buffer zone. In this buffer zone, the prey strive and thrive and do better than if there is no such hostility. And you can see that this saying goes with the population here, the population of wolves. So not only is the population of prey doing better, but the population of wolves also does better. That's really quite surprising. Because we have a situation where you have now two groups. Whenever they meet, they kill each other. So there's a very strong hostility between the two packs. So there are a lot of losses in this model. That's why it's so small here. They cannot go very far. There are very lot of losses. Nevertheless, because of this interaction with the prey, they do overall, the total population does better. And that is really the main point of this study. Let me just say a few things about the fact that there are many similar models, systems of reaction diffusion or nonlinear parabolic equations that arise in the literature. One important such system which has led to very large mathematical literature is the so-called Gross-Pitayevsky system, which in particular is concerned with Bose Einstein condensates with n phases, with several phases. So Bose Einstein condensates lead to a system which is essentially like the one before. So while it's a Schrödinger equation rather than the heat equation, so I dt wk minus Laplace wk equals wk, vk some potential minus mu k w squares. This is like the same term as before. And now here you have minus 8kj wj squared. But j is different from 1. So it's important. There are many papers about the system. They're also quite interesting in understanding what's happening when there is a very large factor here. So segregation of phases is something which happens also in Bose-Einstein condensates. You can have separation of phases. And it's related to, so you can study this. But I want to say there are two main differences to keep in mind, if you have seen this before. The fact is that this system is a variational system. It's derived from an energy. In particular, it's symmetric in all its components. Whereas what we study is fundamentally not a variational system. It's fundamentally non-symmetric because there is this complete difference between prey and predators. So Bose Einstein condensates is not a system with prey predators because it's variational. Yet you can do a lot of things, and people have studied this, a lot of things, what's happening when you have here, think of this EKJ having an amplitude factor lambda here, or I called it beta, and beta goes to infinity. There are very interesting mathematical studies, including things which are related to a few things I will mention at the beginning here. Okay, so this is this. But then also I should mention very important work of Denzer and Du. Denzer and Du looked at competing prey, if you want. So a system, there is no predators and prey, there's just prey, if you want, or animals. And they compete between each other. So there is no interaction with a third group animal. And so you have exactly the same equation as before, and here you have just an interaction due to competition, so a certain minus C, W1, W2, minus E, those are positive constants. And so it's quite different in some sense. Okay, so this is internal competition, that's it. They both compete for the same food, and that's it. Or between themselves. Not taking into account the fact that there is an interaction with a prey. So it's quite different to understand. So they studied existing solutions using topological methods. They again used a strong competition when these guys go to infinity, say C and E. And one of the things they observed using the maximum principle is that in this case, competition is always disadvantageous. Namely, if you have competition, if you have this C and E of competition, you do worse than if you don't have competition, right? So it's completely different from what I just showed you before. So that could be, we think, could be misleading in the sense that you can think that competition is always disadvantageous, whereas we are going to show that competition in this case can be advantageous. Maybe a sad conclusion, but we are scientists, right? So let me later also tell you about related literature. There's a beautiful paper of a beautiful series of papers, really, of Mark Lewis and Jim Murray. Murray is this famous mathematician who wrote this treatise on mathematical biology. And he, actually, the first time I got the intuition of the role of buffer zone was from a lecture I heard by Jim Murray in Paris. And they did this study by showing that there are these buffer zones, really. So the difference here is that they take territories as given. So the territories of walls are given. They start with a location of dents. So they use this data from that I showed you before, or at least the data was used later to compare with the consequences of this model. So there is a location of dents, so which are considered as centers, if you want, for this population. And it relies a lot on scent markings, PI. So there's a certain density of markings that each pack leaves. You know what scents are, right? You know what scents, you know how wolves mark their territory, I suppose. Right? So it's urinating, so it's by urine. So these animals are very good at recognizing urines of different packs. They can immediately spot if an animal is from their pack or not. I find it amazing, but it's true. And so there is a certain dynamics for the scent marking. So when animals are there, they increase the scent. Otherwise, there is a time decay of the scent. This is the fact that the animals have been there and leave their marks. And likewise, here there is a Neumann condition. And the WI equation obeys a certain law, which is not the Laplacian, but it's directed diffusion, because they want to go back to close to their center. They want to go back, and they want to drift away from places where there is other scents from other packs. So this is quite different in the sense that they take for granted what the territories are, and what they do, this model does, is to observe that there is a formation of buffer zones, which I think is a very important consequence. So another important work I want to mention here is a work by Dockery, Hudson, Mishaikov, Pernarovsky of 1998, and they look at the case of many species competing for the same resource. So it's the same spirit of the work of Du and Denser that I mentioned before. So, but you have several species. So there is only competition between them. There is no prey here. There is only animals competing between themselves. And one of the things that they prove, the Docker is a well-quoted result, is that if you take an A of X, which is non-constant, so there is certain regions which are more advantageous for the animals. So when A is large, it's more advantageous. The intrinsic growth rate is A of X here. It can be larger than certain areas and smaller at other areas. So an A of X is not constant. What they prove is that the only stable solution for this is the one when all components are zero except the one. So you take species with different diffusion coefficients, D1, D2, Dn. And so the only asymptotically stable solution has all components zero except the one with the smallest diffusion. This is a very much quoted result. It has allowed to explain certain observations. But you can think what it means, right? You would think that being able to move is an advantage. But so what happens here? So the animals, move around at this random movement, and when they get close to food, they continue to move around. So in this case, so the faster diffusion animals will get first to the food. Initially, they would do better than their competitors, but in the slower diffusers will move at the slower, will arrive later at the place where there's good food. But once they are there, they will stay there. And eventually, in long time, they will overtake the other population. So the slower, in the Dockery model, the slower diffusion, somewhat paradoxical, slower diffusion wins. And again, it has been used to confirm certain data. But is it true or not? I want to show you some conclusion to show the fact that, in general, this is not true. But in this framework, it is true. And this was shown, it's shown mathematically. I want to show you that this model, the model we introduce here, can be shown to have a link with the Dockery model when there is no competition. Let me not say... let me not say much about this, but basically if beta is equal to zero, and in certain case, when certain limiting case, when the evolution of D is very small, the evolution of U is very rapid, so there is no time derivative, D is very small here, and so on, you can replace and get a system when beta is equal to zero, so when there is no competition, you get a model, you get the model of Dockery and others. So you see the difference between the two, right? In here, there is only competition for the same resources, this apparent competition, and here we have really the individuals interfere, the groups interfere with one another. So there's different type of competition. It's more general. So this model contains, in some cases, a particular case, this one, but in some very limiting, but limiting particular case when beta is equal to zero. Okay, so so let me come back to the typical, to the system that I want to discuss here. So remember, we have this equation for U, we have an equation for Wi, and you have this competition term beta that involves Wi with all the other groups. And otherwise, we have the same Lotka-Volterra. So here are some theorems we were able to prove. So first of all, this system is well posed. There is a unique solution. Start with initial positive smooth initial data, there is a unique smooth solution for all times, and the solution will remain uniformly bounded for all times when further on. And the next result is says that in some regimes, in particular when lambda k is less than mu omega, then Wi will go to zero when t goes to infinity. So all the predators will become extinct. When this happens, all the predators will become extinct. Let me tell you what this is. So what is this condition, lambda k less than mu omega? So omega is the mortality rate, the decay rate for predators. So in particular, when the decay rate is very large, they don't, even if they eat a lot of prey, they don't survive. I mean, all else fixed. If omega is too large, they won't survive, they won't make it. The predators will disappear. There's just too much loss of this. Mu is a maximum carrying capacity of omega. The interpretation of this is a little bit more delicate in this formula here. But the important thing is this one. Mu is the inverse of the carrying capacity. The interpretation is a little bit more delicate. Remember, it's lambda over mu, the carrying capacity. So what this says is that if the environment is not favorable enough for prey, predators will die out. So if the carrying capacity is too small for the prey, the predators don't survive. So that's this term here. Now, k is a predation rate. So if the predation rate is too small, it's not efficient enough, so the animals kill the prey, they don't gain enough for it, they don't survive either. And likewise, lambda here is a reproduction rate of prey, not of... So when the prey... You know, the preys are killed and they don't reproduce at a fast enough speed, the predators will not survive because they kill. It's true they eat, but then there is not enough left. It doesn't reproduce at fast enough rate. So you see that this has a very interesting biological interpretation. And in this case, you see it's similar to spatially homogeneous ODE case, really. So in fact, one can show more precisely here there's a certain invariance region, and one can apply to this system a general theorem, which was proved by Conway, Hoff, and Smoller, which says that there is a certain, let me not go into the complete part of this, but saying that if this constant here, which involves the principal non-zero eigenvalue of the Laplacian operator with Neumann conditions, is positive, then this solutions will become homogeneous. You remember I showed you some pictures where they become homogeneous, in particular when beta was small, when beta was zero. And you can see that here this condition is violated in particular in these cases, when the carrying capacity becomes very large, when the competition becomes very large, the competition that is the hostilities, the animosity between different packs becomes very large. So this becomes very large, and therefore L becomes very large, and therefore this is violated. So this, at least, you cannot derive from this condition. Likewise, when omega is very large, you know the principal eigenvalue go down when the domain increases homothetically, let's say. So gamma 1 becomes large, and therefore this will become also violated. So the question is, in those regimes, which we see when this is violated, in those regimes, in particular when beta is large or when omega is large, do we have coexisting solutions? So solutions which are not homogeneous in space. Here's the theorem, is that they become homogeneous in space. And we can look at the first case of two species simply. So this is a case with two packs, omega 1, W1, W2. And we can analyze completely the existence of solution stability for this system. So in particular, we start with this assumption, which you have seen is necessary if we want to analyze non-constant solutions, non-trivial solutions. And so in this case, we can, let me maybe go over this. So the main point I want to underline here is this one. So there exists, you can find certain stationary solutions, but the main point I want to say is this one. Here you can prove, that requires a proof, of course, that when beta n goes to infinity, then U, W1, W2, for beta n will converge to a solution of the limiting problem, of some limiting problem when beta n is infinite. And what is a limiting problem? It's a problem when there is no overlap. The populations are completely segregated. So W1 infinity is a limit one. W1 infinity, W2 infinity vanish, the product vanish. So when one is non-zero, the other is zero. So they don't overlap. There is segregation. There's complete segregation of populations. And we will see this in a moment. Let me also, let me go a little bit faster here on this thing. So you can analyze this, particularly the simple solutions. So the zero solution is unstable, so we have a KPP equation. The solution without predators is also unstable because we have a Lotka-Volterra system. And then you have semi-trivial solutions when one component is zero, and these are stable. And then you have also a third family of constant solutions where you can just compute from the equation, and this is unstable, of these solutions. But more important, so these are the... So the what is interesting here to observe, first observation is here, is that if you look at what I just have said, all semi-trivial solutions, so the solutions which are this one and this one, both are stable. So you see that this is in sharp contrast with Dockery's, the famous Dockery result. Dockery result says only one component, only the slowest diffusion is stable. And in this case, you see the fact that there is interaction with the prey makes it so that both semi-trivial solutions are stable. So it's quite different from Dockery's result, and because we can extend this result to cases of different diffusions. Okay? So, and now if you want to look at solutions, coexisting solutions, you can get them through a bifurcation analysis. So you follow these constant solutions like this, in particular this branch, the unstable branch of constant solutions. If we call gamma 1, gamma 2, as a non-zero eigenvalues of minus Laplacian with Neumann condition, the following theorem holds. Whenever gamma n is less, so the nth eigenvalue is less than this number, remember, there is again this condition that this guy is positive. Remember, when this is negative, all solution, the predators become extinct. So if this is larger than gamma n, and gamma n has odd multiplicity, and okay, then there exists a branch Cn, which starts at beta equals beta n, which either connects two bifurcation points or is unbounded in beta. So this tells you that there is, I'll show you in the picture in a minute, so there is bifurcation of solutions which are non-constant at this point. And this is obtained through a very famous result of Paul Rabinowitz, which is a global bifurcation result of Rabinowitz. Let me show you a picture. And of course, you need to have a priori estimate. So the picture is this one. You have this branch of solutions. So this is U, this is W1 equals W2, and here you get these solutions bifurcating from these values. And this is the solution. Is this unbounded in beta, or sometimes you cannot preclude the fact that it comes back to another bifurcation point, maybe elsewhere. And you have a finite number of those, okay? You have a finite number of those because it relies on ends which are bounded from above by a certain thing. In dimension one, you can go, you can be much more precise. You know what gamma n is, it's this one. And in fact, in gamma n, always all the branches are unbounded. And they never come back to another bifurcation point because you can separate them by the number of oscillations. And let me go over this because I don't want to lose you in too many details. Okay. So let me come back to this question. So I want now to discuss. So you see, we can say very precisely, in dimension one, we can say completely how every one of these branches are, how many there are, and so forth. And let me come back to this system. And let me, what we are interested in here is to say, what happens when beta goes to infinity? What happens to this system when we have very large competition? You remember from a previous theorem we have proved, which I just quoted, which is a hard theorem in some sense, to say that whenever you have beta goes to infinity, you have convergence up to subsequence, of course. You have convergence to a certain state, and this state is a fully segregated state. That is a W. Each component, there's only one component which is non-zero at every point. They never, two components never overlap. And so we have this, and we're interested in saying how many of these can be non-zero, right? So what we know is that they don't, the product of two of these guys is always zeros. That is, they never overlap. But it could be that we have a partition in how many different packs can we partition this domain. So the theorem here we prove, which says that the limit here has at most a certain number which we call P max, so maximal number of packs, plus one. One is for the prey density. So a certain number P max of predators that are non-trivial. So that's a very very interesting formula. It says that a given environment, given everything, all the other parameters fixed, given environment can sustain at most a certain number of maximal number of packs. You cannot fit in as many packs as you want. And by using Weyl's formula for the asymptotic behavior of eigenvalues, and as a result related to eigenvalues, we have an estimate for Pmax. So Pmax is a maximal capacity of packs in omega, and in dimension two, so it depends very much on dimension. Pmax is less than or equal to a certain number, which we obtain here. Remember, this is our old friend lambda k minus mu omega, which we assume to be positive. It's negative, no predators, right? Divided by d mu, and here comes the volume of omega, or the area of omega in dimension two, divided by 4 pi. So let me discuss a few consequences of this formula. It's quite, it's really quite a remarkable formula. So here's this formula I wrote for you, and you see that this number Pmax, or this estimate of the number Pmax, to be more precise, this number Pmax, first of all, increases when omega increases. You expect this. You expect that the larger the domain, the more you should be able to fit packs. Take a very large domain, you expect, if all else is kept constant, you expect to have a larger number of packs. Furthermore, if lambda increases, lambda is a reproduction rate of preys. If lambda increases in a given domain, it means that whenever they are left alone, the preys, they will grow. They will grow very fast. So if this situation, you have there is a favorable element in having many packs, because many packs means that there will be many buffer zones. So the larger the lambda, the more packs you think you can put here. Likewise, if the predation rate increases, you expect to have larger number of packs. And if mu decreases, remember mu is a maximum carrying capacity. So again, if mu decreases, it means that in an area where the predators are by themselves, there is no limitation due to the environment on how much they can grow. So this, the fact that you have a large carrying capacity will tell you that you have the possibility of a larger number of packs. And lastly, if D is a mobility of predators, if the predators move very fast around, so if D is large, then the number of packs should decrease, because as soon as you have two packs, you know, as soon as you have two packs, think of this. You have two packs with a large mobility. So the animals, they are just move around, but they move around quite largely. So many of them will wander in the enemy's territories and will be killed there. So when you have a large D, then the advantage of having many packs is reduced. It's reduced, is offset by the fact that you have a large mortality due to random movement. And so if D decreases, if predators tend to stick to where they are, then you can have more packs. You see that this formula has a lot of biological content in it, and interestingly enough, about what is the maximum number of packs. Okay, so let me just tell you this about non-homogeneous solutions. First of all, if mu is positive, so very large beta here, so when the limit beta goes to infinity, if mu is very large, then, so very small carrying capacity, there are no stationary solutions with predators. W1 is equal to W2 is equal to 0. This means that it's a very inhospitable environment for the prey, even. So when you reduce mu, there are solutions with only one density of predators, but no solutions with, so there is one undistinguishable group, but no solutions with two or more groups. So this we call, so the first one is related to inhospitable environment. The second one is called the principle of competitive exclusion. There is not enough room here to have many, many, many predators. If you continue to reduce mu, then there are also solutions to densities of predators. And lastly, when mu is much smaller than one, so it's sufficiently small, what is happening is that we can prove that the total population of predators with two groups is larger than the total population with one group. So you see, so in other words, the P max is going to be larger than one. So you see, that's quite a remarkable conclusion in some sense. So given a domain omega, if mu is sufficiently small, the total population of predators, which is this one, this number here, total integral of wi summed from 1 to n, this total population is higher when you have two or more competing groups than in the case of non-competing animals. So this is a situation where if you have two very aggressive packs of animals that kill each other whenever they meet, so there is a loss due to hostility between the groups, the overall effect is positive on the population size because of the buffer zones. So in other words, this tells you that you can have territoriality. Territoriality has an advantage, even if you don't need to go to hunting strategies or offspring. Social behavior can be a consequence of territoriality. Territoriality can be also a consequence of the simple fact that due to the interaction with prey, some territorial behavior is advantageous in terms of the total size of the population. This is a consequence, and I think we cannot. This would be hard, you know. We really need a mathematical model to say this, because it's somewhat not so obvious intuitively. But the mathematical model tells you really with precision that this is the case here. And so the conclusion here is that we have proposed a model to compare situations with various numbers of packs. It's a predator-prey model with strong hostility between the packs. We have shown existence of solutions. We can analyze stationary solutions with bifurcation analysis. We analyze a singular limit. This requires a lot of PDE type of developments that I didn't show you. The limit beta goes to infinity. Those are singular limits, really. So because you have, in the end, you have a free boundary problem. So you have, like in the lecture materials, you have boundaries forming here. And there is a certain optimality of the number of packs. in the solution in terms of total population of predators, you can optimize n, and the conclusions are that a given environment can support only a maximum number of packs. You cannot do arbitrary number of packs. So this maximum number can be analyzed in terms of various biological parameters here. In certain regimes of parameters, in particular, for instance, when omega is large enough or the carrying capacity is large enough, the total population of predator is larger when there are several very aggressive groups fighting one another rather than a single passive population. I want to mention just a few words. There are also applications to social science, but let me just say that perspectives, there are many open problems. It's just the beginning, I feel, of this. It would be interesting to study more carefully all the possible solutions that can arise. Dynamics, in particular, traveling fronts, invasion, the beautiful problems to be studied, completely open yet. What is the optimal shape of territories? Again, that's very nice. We have numerical studies. I don't have time to show them. But it's interesting. It's quite related to what we saw in the lecture by Professor Srolowitz earlier. And, of course, we'd be interested in understanding the extensions to more general systems and comparison with data. But to conclude, let me just show you two related facts. So one is application to sociology. So in fact, there is a model about criminality, but in fact, very specifically about gangs in LA. So there is a group in LA who has been working on criminality. I'm sure many of you are aware of this. And there's a lot of, this is quite visible. And in particular, this group around Bertozzi, Andrea Bertozzi in particular, had many models of criminality. So in one study, which is different from this criminality model, Smith, Bertozzi, Brantingham was an anthropologist. George Tita was a specialist of LA gangs. He's written a book about LA gangs, we're quite knowledgeable. And Valachik in 2012 used the Lewis Murray model, the model I showed you with sense. So what he says is that the population of predators are the criminals or the gang members, and what is equivalent to scent marks are the tags. You know, each in the city of LA, each gang marks its territories by tags. You know, they write this thing. It's very different from one group to another. And they have data. They collected data, actually, on the tags, on the presence of tags. And so they adapted the model of Lewis and Murray to this type of interaction. So the gangs, the packs would be gangs, if you want. So criminals are the predators, packs are gangs, and markings are graffiti, tags or graffiti. And by using this model, they derived certain things which were quite interesting and quite relevant to the model. But again, in this case, the territory is given, right? And we can do the same. The model I described for you works quite well in this situation as well. Of course, preys are not like the honest average people that walk in the street and are going to be mugged by criminals. You have to understand the preys as something else. So preys here will be a number of economic goods or public services that are needed for a city to function. So if you have a situation where you have criminals everywhere, of course, public services will decrease to below level that are necessary to function. But in places where there are no criminals, the things will public services can enter and will function better. So it's an analogy at this level, but I think it's a deep analogy, really. And if you do that, you see, it's exactly the same type of interaction. When there's buffer zones between gangs, that's where the sub-public services penetrate the city. And it applies, this is a map of different gangs in LA. Quite well-shaped territories. Of course, they have straight lines of boundaries because they are blocks, but it's quite well-shaped. And it, you know, this type of study I was telling you about allows to answer a very fundamental question of social sciences, which is, why do you have many gangs? Why would you have many gangs? You know, in the end, the gangs fight one another. you should have one gang which overwhelms all the other and becomes there is only one gang. Why don't you have one gang in LA? Why do you have so many? And the model I described to you explains this. It provided you interpret the WI as the praise as being the necessary goods and services that are needed for a city to function. So that's what it is. The next one is Chicago. But you see, Chicago is different. So this we don't understand that well because boundaries, you have larger buffer zones. Maybe it's related to the city. But anyways, in Chicago, it doesn't function that well, actually. But OK, so the last thing I wanted to say is that you may think also of interaction of different kinds. You may think of long-term, long-distance interactions, non-local distance interactions. So for instance, instead of the Laplacian, you can have a non-local operator. Or you may think that the individuals of the two predators will interact at larger distances. I think this is for you. They may interact at larger distances. And you have here a convolution with a certain kernel, which makes this problem much harder in some sense. And why is it so? So for instance, humans would tend to interact with enemies at larger distance. Okay, that's a very interesting extension, which is we are very far from understanding here. But I want just to mention one last application. This one has really interesting, unexpected applications in the preservation of biodiversity. There is one place in the world where biodiversity has grown in an unbelievable manner. You know what is this place? No, well, maybe also there, but there's one place a little bit unexpected, is the Korean Demilitarized Zone. Why don't I see it? Here it is. So the Korean Demilitarized Zone, so the buffer zone between North and South Korea, is this region here. You have basically the frontier, if I understood well, the boundary, the official armistice line is this one, and you have a boundary here. Yeah, I think so. And the boundary is there. And this is a demilitarized zone, the green, very green area. And it has just been an incredible place for biodiversity. So this is a demilitarized zone, and it has been reported. You know, it has been reported in quite remarkable articles in National Geographic, in Science. There's a very serious article in Science magazine about the biodiversity preserving in the KDZ, sorry, and and you have many articles if you look at that. The accidental paradise of the DMZ. So this is an example where the fact of having a buffer zone has an incredible effect, which is positive of this. So let's ask an expert what's the right model to use here. This is the right model. So with this, I will conclude. Thank you for your attention.
I have one first. So you've proven the number of packs, you have upper bound. Do you have a lower bound as well?
No, but we know that it's larger. We know we can compare with one. Okay, so we know that in many instances it's larger than one.
Right.
That's what we can prove. In dimension one, I should say, by the way. Our proof for the moment only works in dimension one.
Oh.
And in dimension one, we can prove that it's larger than one. We don't, I think, would be very, so this is exactly an interesting direction to, because there are many open and interesting, fascinating questions. So how can you describe what the number exactly is? Can you have a hold on this? Estimates from below is a very good question. You're absolutely right. But also in higher dimensions, dimension two in particular would be very interesting.
It's not
what is the effect of the shape of the domain, for instance,
right,
on this would be very interesting. We have some numerical computations on this. That's a very good, very good point.
Yep. So you showed the example of the number of wolf packs, I think, in Yellowstone. Is there any way to get numbers like that from your model?
So this is that's also a very good point you're raising. We didn't do it yet, but I would like to. So this is a perspective to compare with data. So for this, we need to set a number of constants in the parameters, like the diffusion coefficients, the mobility coefficients, the predation rate and so on, or the beta, the beta is infinite here. So we didn't do it. The answer is that we didn't do it yet. But what I hope is to show that if you have an elongated territory, then the things will not will form a series, elongated series of packs, rather than if you have a circular territories, then you have packs which are situated in different places around. If you have an elongated, it will be one after the other, like what we have seen. So this we can see, but comparing with numbers, I hope that we will do that. It's clearly an important element to confirm this theory, but we have not done it yet. It's an important point. But at least the shapes, we can say something. We can say something about the shapes. At least numerically, we can say something about the shapes.
And they seem to be in agreement.
So are they real thetas compared with the model?
Yeah, so the first one I showed you, you know, the very first one, the first picture I show you are really data which were collected from coyotes. These are really data. So it's quite fascinating to see how precise, because they were able to identify each, to which pack each animal belongs. And they followed that and with satellites and so on. So these are quite remarkable data. But, you know, So this would be the first thing to try, and it's related to the previous question. It would be very interesting to. These are data. These are really observations, but I could, you know, I can imagine even experiments, certain experiments. It's not easy to do, but I could imagine this. Yeah. But yeah, that would be very, very interesting to compare. You know, I'm not. I think that the sociological model could also be perhaps written a little bit more specifically. So you need to know what's the equivalent of praise. And then we could, then maybe there is something to be compared with data, because we have very good data for the LA situation. And it would be very interesting to know if this corresponds to anything that we get from such a model. But the fact that you have segregation and many, you know, that you don't have a single gang, but that it's advantageous to preserve buffer zones in a city, I think is a very clear explanation.
So is Potosi doing some similar study, right?
Yeah.
So is her model similar? Or?
No. So what they did, Bertozzi, Bantingham, Tita in particular, Tita is Smith, Bertozzi, Bantingham, and Tita. But what they did was they used the Lewis and Murray model. So the Lewis and Murray model assumes that you have the territory is given, and at least the center of the territory is given. And then each one, each individual, when it arrives at a place where there is scent marks, or in the case of gangs would be graffitis from another group, will tend to go away from it. We'll also have, we'll want to go back towards the direction of the center. So centers are given. What is different here is that you can somehow, through a variational problem, unconventional variational problems, you can say something about how many there are. But in the Lewis-Murray, and where, what is their shape? In the Lewis-Murray model, this number is given. You just start from a situation where you have a number of packs, a number of gangs, and each one is located at a certain point. And then, you know, away from it, they move away from it, but not too far. And then the graffiti plays the role of sets, which I think is a very interesting idea. But this model is different. We start from something which has less a priori things in it. We don't impose how many packs there are. We just find it as a result.
Sometimes the system may evolve from one equilibrium state to another equilibrium state. Yeah. Model.
Yeah, this is also a very good question. No, the dynamics remains to be understood, and this is something which is not very clear for us at this point. The dynamics, what's the dynamics and how it passes from one equilibrium to the other, is not, we don't understand this yet. Presumably there is something about the different types of stability you may have, or that you can, when the parameters change, you have stable to unstable and then change to another equilibrium, probably, but this is to be done. The dynamics part is really very fascinating, and understanding invasions, for instance, so traveling waves would be a way to understand invasions, a situation when there's only one pack, eventually there's a wave advancing with several packs. Would be a way to understand how this transition like that happens. And I think that's a very interesting problem from PDE point of view, traveling waves, very interesting problem. And indeed, would shed some light on the question you're raising.
Okay, then let's thank Henri again and ending. Okay.